لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله اللهم اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
I would like to just welcome you all to tonight's lecture. It's good to see that you know, we have brothers and sisters here who come with their families, most importantly, and they come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they benefit with their time. Inshallah, we will see this playing in front of us on the day of judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls us to account. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be sincere and accept these deeds from us. One of the greatest teachings that Islam offers us, that Islam presents to Muslims, is that it teaches us that every man and every woman will be held accountable for his or her own deeds. Meaning everybody is responsible for themselves. If you do good, you will receive good. هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. If you do evil, then this will only lead you down an evil path. And on the day of judgment, when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing we will present to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our deeds. And these deeds will either work for us or they will work against us. حُجَّ لَنَا أَوْ عَلَيْنَا. They can benefit us and give us what we want, or they can lead us to a severe punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and protect us from such punishment. Now, throughout the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his main cause, his main goal was to call people to deeds that would bring them goodness in their lives, would bring them benefit, and would bring them, at the end of the day, a great reward. But at the same time, he would warn people. He would warn people of deeds that will lead to anger, that will lead to sadness, that will lead to punishment, and that will lead to pain. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was playing both cards, telling us to do good, at the same time telling us to stay away from that which is haram. And this is the same statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes in the Quran. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ. Anything that the Prophet gives you, you should take it. And anything that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbids you to do, then you should stay away from it. Because at the end of the day, on the day of judgment, a day that is 50,000 years, not like the 24-hour days that we're used to, a day that is 50,000 years, a day where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes that man will be standing, creation of Allah will be standing. The Prophet described them as being standing barefoot, meaning no shoes, naked, and uncircumcised, meaning as if he was resurrected, because he is resurrected, back into his original state. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she heard, she said, won't people be caught off guard by this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, al-amru ashaddu min thalik, meaning the situation that day will be more severe, more tense than anything you could imagine. It's not a big deal. So you're standing there, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, what is he saying? He's saying that people will be drowning. Some people will be up to sweat to their ankles. They'll be sweating up to their ankles. Some people will be sweating up to their knees. Some people will be sweating up to their waist. And some people will be drowning in their own sweat. And this is all a result of their deeds. It's a result of their deeds and what their hands have put forth. Meaning the people who have done good deeds, they will not be in this situation. But for those who neglected the deeds that they were supposed to do, and in turn ending up doing the deeds that they weren't supposed to do, they will be the ones who will be drowning on the day of judgment. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also explains why they will be sweating so much. They'll be sweating so much because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the sun will be slowly making its way closer and closer and closer to the earth until it reaches a mile from our heads. Now, how far is the sun away from us? 93 million miles away from us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that the sun is going to be a mile from my head. I can't believe this. We must believe this. This is ilm al-ghayb. This is the knowledge of the unseen. Just because our minds can't comprehend this scenario or this situation, it doesn't mean it does not exist, and it doesn't mean it will not happen. Wallahi, it will happen. Absolutely. Sadaqa al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the sun will be so close that people will be in pain, people will be suffering. Talk about sunburn, of course. And there's no type of sunscreen that can protect you from this. Rather, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with something that is better. And this is what I would like to present to you all today. Protection. Protection from fear. Protection from anxiety. Protection from putting your hands into your mouth because you are so overtaken by this stance. Protection of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a gift given to us and given to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Sab'atun, seven types of people. يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ذِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ. Seven types of people. Right? You have SPF 10, SPF 25, SPF 30. This is SPF 7. The seven types of people, they'll be protected on the day where there'll be no shade except for the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what we mean by the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Arsh. The Arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is a magnificent and a great creation. So we're standing. But we can avoid this scenario. So we go into the hadith and we take the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions the first person. And he says that this person is al-imam al-adil. An imam, a ruler who is just. He's just in his statements and in his actions. Now, one thing we need to understand about this hadith is that it's been narrated many a times. And one thing you find when you're looking into the books of the hadith, you'll find that this hadith is sometimes mixed and matched. That the category of these people are not always in the same order. One will come before the other in one narration, and the other will come before the other in another narration. But there's one constant. There's one constant. And this constant is that in every narration, Al-Imam Al-Adil is the first person mentioned. It's the first person mentioned. And this goes back to the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always mention Al-Imam Al-Adil before he mentioned any other category? Well, when you have a just ruler, then your country or your people will flourish. When you have an unjust ruler, then it's the complete opposite. Now, you have a person, you have a man, you have a woman who's been given power. And she's unjust or he is unjust in the way that they deal with this power. What is the result? The result? Chaos. The result? Violence. The result? Bloodshed. The result? Crime. Every type of evil you can think about, this will be the result of it. Because the leader, that individual himself, is evil. There is no justice. Corruption everywhere. On the other hand, If you look at an imam, a qadi, somebody with power, a governor, a president, a prime minister, and they carry this quality or this attribute of justice, then it becomes easier for the other categories to come into play. These categories can actually happen. These categories, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, a young man or a young woman who grows up in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's easier and more likely to happen under the rulership of a just ruler. People who love to come to the masjid, their hearts are stuck in the masjid. Nobody's saying mamnu'. You cannot go to the masjid, as in some cases in some Muslim countries. People will begin to love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is another category. People will stay away from fahisha wa munkar. They will stay away from these evil and indecent actions. People will start giving money because they know if they need help, they can go to that ruler and that ruler will help them out. And people will look within themselves and contemplate their evil actions and be real with themselves. And this all starts with a just ruler. We call it the domino effect. You knock one domino down, the rest are bound to fall. And it all starts with justice. Because our deen is based on justice. The justice that we serve to ourselves, the justice that we serve to others, and the justice that we serve most importantly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we look at the companions and the lives of the companions radiallahu anhum, we find them to be great individuals, wonderful individuals. And this goes back, and this we should accredit this to the leadership of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the just leadership of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before the Prophet became a prophet, he was living in Mecca. And at the time, Mecca was corrupt. Mecca was corrupt. There were 360 idols around the Kaaba where people were worshipping these idols. And there were people who were fornicating in the open streets. There were people who were drinking alcohol non-stop. There were people who were indulging in usury, riba. There were people who were even killing their own newborn daughter. فَبِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ Allah is even asking them, where's the justice? Why do you murder? Why do you kill this innocent child? There was no justice. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with prophethood. And everything changed from there. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made his hijrah to Medina. And when he came into Medina, he started to establish the first Islamic society. And the foundation of that society was justice. There was a woman there. There was a woman. She came from a great family, from a very well-known and well-off family. Her name was Mansif. And this woman, she was accused of stealing. So she was sent to court, and it was decreed that she is guilty. Therefore, they decreed that she should be punished according to this crime. So the people and her friends and her family and her tribe, they gather and they say, how are we going to stop this from happening? This can't happen to one of us. So they went to a companion by the name of Osama bin Zayd, because he was close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they said to him, oh Osama, go tell the Prophet, ask the Prophet if he can just let this slide for once and give her just a slap on the wrist and she'll be on her way. So when Osama approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he got angry, he got upset. He said that Bani Israel, when a rich person were to have committed a crime, they would try and manipulate the situation so they could avoid the punishment. But when a poor, miskeen individual committed a crime, they were quick to rush him to punishment right away. And then he goes on to say, Wallahi, and he swears by Allah, لو فاطمة بنت محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, if Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, my daughter, he's saying, if my daughter were to steal, then I would punish her the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered me to punish her. Now this teaches us two things. The first of which is the complete and total justice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the second is the love that he has for his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha wa alayha salam. How? He could have said, وَلَوْ مُحَمَّدْ بِنْ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ, if Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, were to have stole, then he will be punished according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ordained. But instead, he used his daughter because he loves his daughter and he puts her at a higher level than he does himself. And this teaches us about the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There was a young man from the Ansar, a young man like your guys' age, mashallah, tabarakallah, shabab. And he was fooling around and he was joking around, and it was narrated that this was at a time where the Muslims were getting ready to go out for a ghazwa, for a battle. And he was joking and he was laughing with his companions. He was having a good time. And he was actually causing a ruckus. People were becoming annoyed. So the Prophet ﷺ went up to him and stuck him with his fingers in his ribs. And told him, you know, calm down a little bit. This is not the time or the place. This young man, he looked at him ﷺ and said, I want my revenge. He said, what? He said, I want my revenge. You hurt me when you poked me, Ya Rasulullah. He's just a kid. The Prophet said, you want your revenge? Take the stick. So the Prophet gave him the stick. And he said, go ahead. He's like, wait a second. You have a shirt, and I don't have a shirt on. You poked me without a shirt. So take your shirt off. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed, you're right. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lifted his shirt, and this young man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and kissed the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, this is all I wanted from you. This is all I wanted from you. The point here is not the fact that the man kissed the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, the point here is how fast the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so quick to implement the attribute of justice. How quick he was. It was a teenager. From me on, cuff, get out of my face. Be on your way. You're just a little kid. Grow up. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no way. Even when it came to minor things, just one more quick story when it comes to the total beauty of the Prophet ﷺ's justice. Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu, he was a young man who accepted Islam at a very young age. And he was once sitting in a gathering, just like this, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he was sitting on the right of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the kibar sahaba, the older companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were sitting towards the right. So a man approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he granted him and he gave him a bowl of milk, and he said, Ishrab ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Drink, O Prophet of Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank a little bit from the bowl. And as you know, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that when you share something with others, you always begin with your right. So to his right was a 10-year-old boy. So he turned to the young boy and he asked the young man, out of his courtesy, do you mind if I offer this bowl of milk first to your elders out of respect and out of justice. He said, yeah, I do mind. I don't want to be wronged from the barakah, from the blessings of drinking the milk and drinking from the bowl right after you. I'm going to drink it. The Prophet ﷺ said, if that's what you want, that's what you get. Because that's the justice of the Prophet ﷺ. He was giving his haqq to those whom deserve it. Al-adl and to addi al-hukuk. Adl, justice, is to give the rights where the rights are due. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ taught us, not only through his statements, but through his actions. Last point when it comes to justice is that we can all be rulers. As a husband, you are the ruler of the home. Therefore, you must be just with the people inside that home, with your wife and with your children, and with anybody who enters into your home. If you're a teacher, you must be just to your students. If you're a business owner, you must be just to your employees. On a micro level, there's the macro level and there's the micro level. You must be just to your employees. You must pay their wages on time. You must give them what they need. And you must be honest with their salary. So there's a micro and there's a macro level. Yes, we may not be kings of countries, but we are kings of our homes. And we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instills the quality of justice in our statements and in our actions. The second individual, as the Prophet ﷺ narrates in the hadith, شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ. شَابٌ, a young man, and it can also mean a young woman. نَشَأَ, meaning they were nurtured, they were raised, and they were energized through the Qur'an and through the Sunnah. And while they were growing up, they weren't memorizing rap lyrics. They weren't turning on the radio and memorizing every beat that came on. And they weren't studying the life of the rich and the famous. Rather, these were individuals, young men and young women, just like you, mashallah, tabarakallah, who memorized and read and understood the Qur'an. And instead of studying the lives of the rich and the famous of this dunya, they studied the lives of the rich and the famous of the akhirah. Six of the 10 men who were granted Jannah while they were alive were teenagers. They were teenagers, just like us. Young men, young women. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them through their Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they will enter into Jannah. I want to share a story of a great companion by the name of Abdullah bin Amr bin As. Now, Abdullah was a young man and he loved to read the Quran, he loved to stand in prayer, and he loved to fast throughout the days. So much so that his father, Amr bin As, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, you know what? I have a problem. The Prophet said, what's your problem? He said, my son, Abdullah, he stands the whole night in prayer and he doesn't sleep. He fasts every day. And he finishes the tilawa of the Qur'an in a single day, from front to back. I need you to speak with him. Nowadays, when parents come to the imams or the counselors, they say, I have a problem. What's your problem? My son, he stays up all night playing Xbox. He eats as much, he eats everything. Everything he sees, he just eats and eats and eats. And the only thing he reads is Facebook statuses and Twitter comments. But look at the problem. So the Prophet said, bring Abdullah to me. They brought Abdullah to him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you like to pray? He says, yeah, I like to pray. He says, how much do you pray? He says, I stand the whole night in prayer. The Prophet said, no, don't stand the whole night in prayer. Wake up the last third of the night and pray. And then go back to sleep for the last sixth of the night. He said, okay, Ya Rasulullah, I'll do that. And he said, I heard you like to fast too. How much do you fast? He said, I fast every day. He said, you fast every day? He said, no. Fast every Monday and Thursday. He said, but Rasulullah, I can do more than that. He said, Tayyib, you want to do more than that? Then fast the 3 days of the month. He said, okay, Prophet, but I can do more than 3 days. He said, okay, fine. Fast the fast of Dawood alayhi salam. You fast one day, you break your fast the next. You fast one day, you break your fast the next. He said, okay, Ya Rasulullah, I'll do that. And he goes, he said, you like the Quran? He said, yes, I really love the Quran. He said, how much do you read it? He says, I read it from front to from the front cover to the end cover every day once. He said, read it once a week. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, please, da'ani astamti'a biquwati wa shababi. Now this is the point that I want to... He said, Ya Rasulullah, just leave me. Please, let me enjoy my strength and my power and my youth. Because I know that when I become older and I get older, it's not going to be the same. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس. Take advantage of five before five. Your youth before your old age. Your health before your sickness. Your wealth before your poverty. Your time before you become occupied. And your life before your death. Take advantage of these things. You're young now. You have time. Maybe you're not working. You're going to school. Summer, you have nothing to do. You have money. You don't have to pay your bills. You don't have rent. You don't have insurance. You don't have to pay for a wedding. I'm sure the young guys can relate. You have strength. You know the circle of life? You start out weak. You're born weak. You need people to take care of you. And then you grow and you grow and you grow until you become a teen. You become a shab. By the way, this age of shabun, nasha'a fi ta'atillah. This is a shab in the sharia context is somebody who is from the age of 15 to what age? Does anybody know? 40, very good. 40. So anybody under 40 right now, if you're 39 with a couple of days, you're good. You're still a shab, yani shabab, mashallah. Right? So, we fall under this category. Because this is the time where we have the most money. This is the time where we have the most strength. This is the time where we have the most time, free time. And this is the time where we're also the most healthiest. As we grow old, and as we know that the more you become old, the more you're struck with illness and sickness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure those who are sick. The third individual, رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. A man or a woman whose heart is attached to the masjid. Now, their heart is it, what does that mean? It means when they step outside these doors, they leave their heart right here. So whenever they're out, they're working, or they're out with their families, or they're doing whatever they're doing, they have this inner desire that they want to return to the masjid. Because they left something behind. Their heart is there. When they leave the masjid, the first thing they think about is, how am I going to plan my day that when Salat al-Asr comes in, I'm going to be able to be back here in the Jama'ah. This is how he looks at his relationship with the masjid. So he loves to come to the masjid. And this love is grown and it's developed through recognition. It's grown and it's developed through recognition. Because they recognize that when they come to the masjid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they are the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, I've been able to travel the world. I've been gone for almost 10 years away from my family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them for their patience. I've been gone, but every year I am blessed to come back. And when I come back and I enter the house of my mother and my father, I enter, my mother is willing to give me the air that she is breathing because I'm her guest. Come, my son is here. My father is willing to give me every dollar in his pocket. My son is here. I'm willing to give you anything with you, anything you want. You're my guest. I will take care of you. With all due respect to my mother and my father, I love them and I put them on my head. But Allah is greater. Allah is greater. Allahu Akbar. Anything I want, Allah will give me because I am his guest. I'm having a financial problem, Ya Allah. I'm having a marital problem, Ya Allah. I'm having a physical problem, I'm sick, Ya Allah. He will serve you because you have come to his house to serve him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we come to the masjid, actually when we look at the masjid and the role that it should play in our lives, when the Prophet ﷺ moved to Medina or migrated to Medina, he built, the first thing he did is he built the masjid. And he didn't order the companions, yeah, build the masjid here and sit back and relax. Rather, he would pick up the bricks one by one and he would help build this masjid. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that he who builds a house of Allah, Allah will build a house for him in Jannah. بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ بَيْتٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. He will build a house for you in Jannah. When you come to the masjid, the Prophet knew that every step that his companions would take to that masjid would be a good deed that was given to them and a bad deed that was erased. The Prophet ﷺ knew that when the companions came to the masjid, even when they're sitting in the masjid and it's not the time of prayer, and they were waiting for the prayer, that they would be rewarded as if they were in prayer. And the Prophet ﷺ knew that the best deed that you could do is your salah on time. And the best way to pray on time is to pray in the masjid. Abdullah bin Mas'ud, he asked the Prophet ﷺ, مَا هِيَ أَفْضَلُ الْأَعْمَالِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, الصَّلَاةُ فِي أَوَّلِ وَقْتِهَا. Salah at its beginning time. When the salah comes in, you are ready, you have wudu, and you are ready to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those whose hearts are attached to the masjid. The next category, the fourth category, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّانِ فِي اللَّهِ اجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ. Two people who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when they meet because of Allah. And when they separate because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know how I'm going to make this make any sense. But something like this, this is almost like a triangle, right? We need to understand that when we establish our relationship with others, whether they are our friends, whether they are our family, whether they're even our wives, when we establish a relationship with them, it should be established on the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we establish our relationships on the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it gives us two things. It brings us closer to that person and it brings us closer to Allah. Now you have one person on this side and one person on this side. And as they become closer to Allah, by default they become closer to each other. They become closer to each other because of their love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You might have $100. And now I know the young guys, when you're in high school, you're looking for the guy with the nice car so you guys can go out on the weekend. But what happens when he crashes that car and that car is no longer there? There's no more friendship. Or maybe you have a nice cabin on the lake, but what happens? Your parents sold the cabin, there's no more cabin. You got no more friends. It's because your relationship and your friendship was based on something that didn't even exist, aslan. It wasn't based on something that was for eternity. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, huwa al-hayyul qayyum, la yamut. He is the ever-living. And He will never die, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A man by the name of Abu Idris al-Khulani, he narrated that he walked into a masjid in Damascus. And as he walked into this masjid, he saw a young man with a beautiful smile and a bright face. And he saw that all the people in the masjid were gathering around this man. And he was wondering, who is this man? If the people had a difference of opinion, they would go immediately back to this man. They would go back to him. And he would rectify this difference of opinion. So he asked, who is this man? They said, you don't know who he is? You don't know who this is? This is Mu'adh bin Jabal, one of the greatest companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was in awe. So the next day, the next morning, he came to the masjid before salah. He came extra early. And as he entered into the masjid, he saw Mu'adh radiallahu anhu standing in prayer. So he waited till Mu'adh finished prayer. He waited until Mu'adh finished a prayer. And he said, after he finished prayer, he came up to Mu'adh, Abu Idris, and he said, I love you. Mu'adh looked at him and said, do you love me for the sake of Allah? He said, yes, 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 I love you for the sake of Allah. He grabbed him by his collar and said, do you love me for the sake of Allah? He said, yes, I love you for the sake of Allah. He said, well, I got some good news for you. He said, please tell me. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, meaning this is hadith Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my love is granted to those who love one another for my sake. And my love is granted to those who visit one another for my sake. And my love is granted for those who spend on one another for my sake. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be amongst those who love each other for His sake, who visit each other for His sake, and who spend on one another for His sake. The fifth category, وَرَجُلٌ طَلَبَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ ذات منصب وجمال فقال إني أخاف الله. A man, and in this case it could be a woman, who was called by a man or another woman trying to lure them in to commit an evil sin, fornication, whatever it may be. And he says to her, or she says to him, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ, I fear Allah, stay away. Stay away. This type of person will be shaded on the day where there'll be no shade except for the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you willing to sacrifice the pleasure of this dunya for the pleasure of the akhirah? Are you willing? Because that woman that you see, or that man that you see from afar, who's calling you in, wallahi, they are nothing but the shaitan. They're nothing but the shaitan, dressed up with some lipstick and a nice dress and some steel toe heels, whatever it's called, I don't even know. I don't know. Some buff guy comes up, this is shaitan. You know, we live in an age, we call it the virtual age, that everything we want is at our fingertips. We go onto the internet, and we can be, like, in all honesty, I'm downloading a PDF, an Islamic PDF book, and all of a sudden I get a pop-up with a woman going like this. Come here. Click here. She's calling me. I have a choice. Now I have a choice. She's calling me. I can either click or exit. It's a choice. And that's a choice we're all going to have to make. Inni akhafullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill our hearts with the fear of His punishment. And subhanallah, it's so tough. Because even the society that we live in, it's a society that praises and raises these type of fahisha and munkar. These type of, you know, nudity. It almost puts it in the spotlight. And this is one of the greatest tricks of the shaitan. One of the greatest tricks of the shaitan is that he lures you in with this desire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and protect our youth from such evil actions. Number 6, وَرَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ فَأَخْفَاهَا حَتَّى لَا تَعْلَمْ شِمَالُهُ مَا تُنْفِقُ يَمِينُهُ. A man or a woman who gives sadaqah, who gives charity with so much secrecy that his left hand, it doesn't even know what his right hand is doing. I had a student one time, he said, "What does that mean, his left hand is in his pocket?" No, it doesn't mean that the left hand is in the pocket. It means that this man or this woman has so much ikhlas that he doesn't want anybody to see. And this reminded me of, and it reminds me of the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the first three people to be thrown into the hellfire is a man with knowledge, and a man who goes out fi sabilillah, and a man or a woman who gives charity. So this man or this woman, they're giving charity, but the reason they're giving this charity is for everybody to see. They want everybody to see. So the people will say, "Oh, mashallah, this guy's very generous. They're very rich. They are a rich family, very generous family." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you something, that this person will be brought to account and Allah will ask him, "What did you do?" That person will say, "Wallahi, ya Allah, I gave sadaqah to the masajid, I gave sadaqah to the miskeen, I gave sadaqah to the faqir." He said, "You gave sadaqah, but you didn't give it for my sake. You did it." So the people will say, "MashaAllah, he is generous." And they said that. Now enter into Jahannam. Now enter into Jahannam. Now this doesn't mean that we shouldn't give sadaqah in front of people. Actually, sometimes it's recommended to give sadaqah in front of people because it serves as a means of motivation. Especially when we're having an open fundraiser. Sometimes, you know, the imam, I feel bad for the imam every time he has to get up there. May Allah reward him. It's not what he wants to do, but he has to do it for the sake of Allah and for the sake of the masajid. So he gets up and he asks. In the first couple of minutes, you can see crickets. Until that one man or that woman says, "I will." And in the back of his mind, he's saying, "My wife is going to kill me." Right? But he did it. And then you know what the other guy says? "If this guy's going to do it, I can do it too." And he puts up his hand. That's 5,000, then 10,000, 20, then 100,000. You know what? That first person who put up his hand, he will be rewarded as if he donated 100,000. أَدَّارَ عَلَى خَيْرِ كَفَاعِلِهِ. The one who does good and enjoins good and tells other people to do good, when these people do it, he will be rewarded just as the person who has done it themselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be amongst those who give. And when we give, we do it with true and sincere ikhlas. Last but not least, the last type and the last category. وَرَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهُ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. A man or a woman who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not in the open, not in the masjid, not where everybody is around them, but khaliyan, meaning by himself or by herself, maybe in a room. And he starts thinking, she starts thinking about all the evil they've done in their lives. And their eye begins to swell because of the tears that are rolling down his eyes, coming down his cheek. These tears are protecting his face from Jahannam. When the companions, they heard this, when they started crying, they started wiping their tears all over their bodies. I ain't going down like that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that two eyes will never touch the fire. Two types of eyes. An eye that weeps out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and an eye which stays vigil throughout the night for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning these eyes, they will never see and they will never touch the fire. You know, subhanallah, your eyes can lead you to Jannah or your eyes can lead you to Jahannam. Subhanallah. There was a man who asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow him to enter Jannah because of his deeds. Prophet said, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, are you sure you don't want to enter because of my mercy? He said, no, my deeds. He thought his deeds were good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put his deeds on one side of the scale and put his eyes on the other side of the scale, and it lifted the scale. All his deeds were nothing compared to the evil that his eyes had seen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma ja'al fi basarina nur. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put light in our eyes. So when we see, we only see good. And when we think of the evil that we've done, we shed a tear. These are the seven types of people. These are the people that we all hope to be. And these seven people are not the only types of people who will be shaded on the Day of Judgment. There are many ahadith that talks about the honor of being shaded on the Day of Judgment. But one of the wisdom of the Prophet ﷺ constantly reminding us of these seven people is that because society can be any one of these seven. Society, whether you are rich or you are poor, you are black, you are white, you are male, you are female, you are old or you are young, you can be part of these seven people. You can be 2 out of 7. You can be 3 out of 7. You can even be 7 out of 7. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a 7 out of 7. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shade us on a day that there'll be no shade except for the shade of Allah. Wallahi ya ikhwa, I know it's hard to imagine, but there will be a day. There will come a day when we will remember this lecture. And we will say, Allah, where is the shade? And Allah will grant us the shade bi-idhnillah. Because we are here. We are growing up under the servitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are here because we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We may not be giving money as charity, but we are giving time, and time is money. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our deeds. With that, we finish today's lecture. May Allah bless you all for being here today.